Everyone, please welcome Mark Holmes.
What if I didn't use the mic?
Did you use the mic?
All right. Really don't like microphones.
I was just saying to somebody that the last time I did one of these talks, I tried to cover, or at least touch on, everything I've done since I started making sculpture 38 years ago, and it ended up being an hour and 15 minutes. So I've reconsidered and realized that's no longer possible. So I'm going to try to focus on a couple of strains in my work, lines of thinking that have been sustained over a long period of time, 20, 30 years, but which sort of arrive at two things that I'm currently involved in. So we will deal with this one first. This is one of the pieces that's upstairs. These are obviously wall constructions. They are objects that hang on the wall in sort of unexpected angles. There is never a surface in these, or I think I can support that claim. There's never a surface which is parallel to the wall. So they don't hang on the wall like a painting or a box flat against the wall. Rather, their relationship to the wall, you know, tries to create a more active sort of movement that evokes perspective, for instance, diagonal slicing motions in space. And in that way, they are slightly illusionistic in the way they occupy space through the use of diagonals and things. They are made out of just very lightweight wood ply, birch plywood, eighth inch birch plywood, and then also, in this case, laminated areas of plywood, which then I cut out into quarter inch thick curves on a bandsaw. So their construction is absolutely evident. They sort of narrate their own making. They're very kind of rational in the way they go together. They are characteristic, I think, of one side of my brain as an artist, which views art as a kind of problem to be solved, a little bit like a puzzle, or even a philosophical problem. This is another. This is actually the first, there's six pieces in this group that I've been working on since last summer. And it's the only work I've done in the last, 10 years that doesn't involve color. This is just a single coat of white gesso on their surface. It becomes a little bit like paper. There's a little transparency to the paint as it's absorbed into the wood. There's drawing. This very faint drawing, sometimes which comes through the gesso, sometimes which is laid on top of the gesso, which again corresponds to the sort of logic of their construction. They come out of, they really relate to drawing. I mean, this kind of work I make as a way of drawing, honestly, they are literally drawings. I start with these pieces of wood, drawing directly onto the wood, sometimes using templates so that I can repeat the same form. I then start cutting things out, moving them around, and essentially I'm just looking for something that will surprise and interest me in a way that I haven't done before. They, over time, as I work with these pieces over a period of days, and I might have multiple ones of these going and bringing pieces from one to the other, making more cuts, I use tape to sort of hold things together. So they kind of go from being a drawing action to being a construction kind of action, taping, gluing. But then often as they come together, I'll cut through the whole thing again and take those parts, you know, turn them sort of inside out, so that their forms are very much found through their making. I think something Andrea and I have in common is that I think it's a commitment we have to say to the notion that art is not something we conceive of and then execute. It's rather something that's very much found through a process of making, that making is a kind of thinking, making is a way of discovery. And that's really the case across all of my work. I never sort of think of sculpture as a problem, or art for that matter, as a problem that can simply have a sort of a conceived solution. I've got it. Doesn't work that way, at least not for me. So these things are about, this big, generally. They're also very, very light. I call them cuts, because they're literally almost weightless. When I was a kid, I made all sorts of things, like model airplanes, with hollow wings, and I've always been a guitar player since I was a kid. And I love the feeling of a guitar, the hollowness, the lightness of a really good guitar. Like you can pick up a really good Martin and there's the buoyancy of the object. You can feel the space inside of it from seeing it or the sound of it. And that's one of the things I like about these. So as you move around them, another thing that's important to all of this kind of work of mine is that unlike a painting that hangs on the wall, of course, there's a, there's a right way to be in front of a painting, perpendicular to the surface of the painting. These are always sort of moving us around, You have to do this, and this, and this, and you can see behind them, and there's all sorts of little things that one might discover in their construction. Now, I'm just going to, where are we? I'm just going to show you a bunch of things that are how I got to those. This is from a group of wall pieces from about almost 10 years ago, I think. And these are involve cast plaster and then wooden structures. So this is a mahogany kind of grid. This is part of that grid. This is cast plaster. The materials and the color and the form all become kind of conflated in a way. It's a little hard sometimes to sort out, is that the edge of a material? Is that where the wood stops, or is that where a new color starts? And I've always been interested in those kinds of overlapping, sometimes the implied transparencies where one form starts. We don't know if we're looking at a difference in shape or color or material. It's something, of course, that comes out of the sort of formal tricks of cubism, things that Picasso was experimenting with 100 years ago. But these, for me, come out of, there is that. I'm interested in that history of sort of formal invention that's latent in modernist art, in 20th century art, sculpture especially, but also painting. I'm mostly interested in pursuing that in a way that takes into account the challenges, the kind of disruptions of some movements in the 1960s. And the main one of those is minimalism. In some ways, everything about my own work can be understood as trying to reconcile cubism and minimalism, trying to find some place where those two things, we can sort of keep the central lessons of those two things. It strikes me that there's a lot of bathwater that got thrown out with the baby in the 1960s with minimal art. And I'm really interested in trying to sort of reclaim what I think was lost in the history of abstraction as it moved into a kind of final act of reduction. I began studying sculpture in 1979, or 78, 77, right around there. And, at the time, sculpture especially, but painting too, was really in a time of crisis. now, there was this trauma that had happened, and that was some of the movements that really sort of extreme movements of the 1960s, conceptual art, performance. And I think particularly looking back, minimalism, for those of you who know a little something about minimalism, you know, in its most extreme sort of orthodoxies, people like Donald Judd, Robert Morris, Carl Andre, wanted to reduce art to a just kind of an undeniable, objective, material reality. But at the same time, they wanted to exclude from art all of the sort of humanist, spiritual, poetic, evocative things that art had historically done. They really wanted to reduce it to a kind of a nominal fact, something which could be undeniably true, but perhaps not loaded with a lot of meaning otherwise. And I took my first sculpture class having studied philosophy quite a bit. I just about completed a philosophy major. My father had been a philosopher, and I think that my brain was wired for sort of philosophical categories and theory. And I was just so attracted to the ideas of minimalism. I recognized in them correlations to all sorts of philosophical thinking. And minimalism at the time had evolved into something which was more richly experiential, involved ideas from phenomenology. And I was just enthralled with sort of the ideas of art that had emerged from the 1960s. Also those involving language, that involved the nature of art itself, phenomenology, ontological ideas about the nature of an art object. And so my first real interest in art was through these sort of philosophical interests. And I think I ultimately really arrived at thinking of art as a kind of a philosophical problem. You know? And making sculpture was like doing experimental philosophy for me. So I would cast, you know, make plaster casts off of manhole covers and make rooms full of them from all around Minneapolis. You know? And just a whole range of things that were sort of conceptually based. And the other thing that really influenced my work, or that I think the other reason I became an artist, I'm going to talk and go through some images at the same time, even though I'm not talking about those images. I think the other reason I became an artist is because I had always been just a maker. I always made things with my hands for as long as I can remember. I built buildings in high school. I built model airplanes as a kid. I just had a lot of energy for using my hands and kind of solving problems with my hands. So sculpture seemed like the ideal arena. You know, it was intellectually, it grabbed me as a place of intellectual curiosity, but also as a place where I could legitimize having my hands dirty. And coming from a family of academics, I needed to legitimize having my hands dirty. It was also the other thing that's been quite important, I think, in determining how, you know, how I became an artist is that I grew up in a strange, if I say it now, you won't believe me, but a progressive, politically progressive, theologically conservative family of Christian intellectuals. Uh-huh. I know we don't think that thing exists anymore. It did. And my father was a philosopher, and I think I was drawn to some of the ideas of the abstraction, particularly those of artists like Mondrian, who really come to abstraction as a kind of a spiritual enterprise. I mean, there's no question that their religious frameworks had a huge influence on their thinking. And I think particularly sort of the most abstract religious frameworks that we associate with theological ideas coming out of the Reformation. And so I had an affinity for abstraction that was really rooted in that. All my work has always been abstract. I've never made anything figurative. I've never painted a landscape or modeled a figure, nothing. So yeah, this is just more of these series of wood constructions from within the last 5 years. This is, these things, on the one hand, they're just like wood boxes. They are humble, simple objects. They're like little wood boxes. On the other hand, they create sort of complex optical, perceptual things. They're slippery a little bit. You're never quite sure what you're seeing. You know, is this black? Is it an absence? Is it a hole in the form, or is it something that actually pushes away from the form, or is it on top? Is this notch out of here? There's times when this becomes part of the wall that way. You don't know if what you're seeing is, or the way this oil paint bends around the corner of the form, it sort of flattens the corner. So they sort of conflate color, shape, and then with the sort of construction of the thing and the actual object. And I'm just interested in that kind of play. It's a kind of an ontological formal play that deals with, what am I seeing? What is that? This is a more recent group of objects. Yeah, these are just two images, obviously, of the same piece. And again, these are very, very light, constructed out of this very, very thin plywood, a lot like a model airplane or a cigar box. In some cases, there's multiple pieces. So the way this is a separate, this is a separate actual object than that. And then sometimes these lines actually are just drawn lines and you're never quite sure which it is. And again, they have this sort of play. I think these is almost like little tumblers, little athletes bouncing along the wall. They have a very kind of a lyrical relationship to the wall. As a way of working, they're a little bit like puzzles. They're very kind of calculated. There's a lot of, how does this thing fit with that thing? And I'm always interested in a kind of logic of making, a logic of construction that feels right, a sense of sort of right fit to things, but which always has, there will be a loose end or a surprise or something that doesn't quite work within that system. It's really important to me that there's something that's left open. There's a sense of something provisional or something that could still happen. They are, the other thing I've been interested in for a long, long time is the way painting, for instance. Paintings are both objects on the one hand, and they are also images on the other. They are something we can understand fully with our eyes as images. They're optical experience, but they are also things, actual objects. So, color, like Andrew was saying, color is the sort of slipperiest of our experiences, I would argue. That the same color appears differently to us every time you turn on the lights in the room, or depending on the light that's coming through the window. Or, that green would change if depending on what I had for lunch, it could be a different color. And that doesn't even take into account the fact that each of us has different associations, they have different optical responses to color. So color is something that I think that's extremely subjective, ultimately. We have ways of categorizing and quantifying it, but that they don't really get at the experience of color. So color is fundamentally unstable, I believe, in perception, whereas the object itself, the reality of the object, is something we can weigh and measure. We know how hard it is. If we drop it, we can, we can hear it. So all of these pieces are really about this sort of slippage and this tension that exists between what we can know with our eyes, these sort of transient experiences of color and light and space, which I think are fundamentally unstable experiences, sort of unreliable in philosophical terms, versus the things which are more stable and objective, or which we at least like to think of as being more objective, things we can really know, like the weight of an object, what it's made of. And that's, I think that's an interest that just runs all the way through my work. Now we're gonna fly, This is a whole other group of wall objects. These are made out of both hardwood, and they're laminated with very thin skins of MDF, medium density fiberboard, which is the color of cardboard. So it's like a very, very neutral material. Something else that had a huge influence on me as an artist is that when I was in graduate school in Connecticut, my wife and I met a pretty famous American artist from the 1940s who is the artist who brought Pete Mondrian to New York during the war. And of course, Mondrian is the sort of the high priest of the utopian ideals of abstraction in the 20th century. And we worked, so he was the Mondrian estate, and we worked for the estate, essentially, for a couple of years. And I became very intimately acquainted with Mondrian's writings, with his ideas as they were transmitted to me directly from people who knew Mondrian well. And it confirmed, on the one hand, it confirmed my sort of commitments regarding abstraction. On the other hand, I began to sort of more skeptically have a slightly deeper, more skeptical relationship with those ideas, particularly the sort of utopian aspirations of that kind of abstraction, the notion that we will change social and political systems and transform human relationships through painting was not something, I mean, I wish, but and so ever since then, I think I've had both a very affirming but also skeptical, hopefully never cynical, relationship with the whole history of abstraction as it develops out of the early mid-20th century. This is a series of, again, little box-like things. These are actually wooden constructions that are covered in linen, laminated with linen. And then the color is oiled wax, so an encaustic that's troweled onto them hot. And then there's these actually relate to the pieces upstairs, but these are unlike those. These are actually heavy. These are solid, sort of 5-inch thick plywood constructions that weigh about 70 pounds a piece. And they're large. These are kind of torso size, between 3 and 4 feet in their length. And they push way off the wall. They're quite gymnastic. I've always loved the work of people like Ellsworth Kelly. All right. So I will just now very briefly show you what I've been, whole other category, the other side of my brain a little bit. A few years ago, I just desperately needed to rediscover something really authentic and fun and engaging in my work. I was dragging myself into the studio. Art became duty and habit. And I was just looking for a way of reigniting. I just thought, either I find a way of working that feels real and honest and joyous, or I should become a writer or a dentist or something. And I started working with clay. I've taught clay for years, but I've never really used clay as part of my own work since as an undergraduate. And clay, you know, all of the work I ever made, all the sculpture I ever made, it started with steel, then wood, plaster, but it's almost entirely been construction, you know? So it really, the whole notion of construction as a way of making has been the dominant mode since, you know, the way we think about sculpture since the beginning of the 20th century. You know, we think of materials like clay and bronze or marble as either retrograde obsessions or part of craft very often, at least in my background. But clay, you know, unlike construction, it's never, it resists any sort of rational attempts to control it. You know, it's mud, it's dirt. And I like this elemental sort of challenge of how do you make wet dirt stand up. I like the way that sort of connected me to something which seemed, which felt really affirming in a, you know, in its relation to things like dolphins and some of the earliest acts of human making. Reconnected me with that kind of energy. But unlike, you know, unlike construction is always, you know, can always be reduced to these taking one thing and joining it to another, or taking one thing and cutting it into two. It's sort of a series of binary actions in that way. And usually, when we construct something, we make, you know, I can make one or two moves. Like you cut out a big shape and attach it to another thing. And those two decisions have largely determined the shape in the end. But with clay, every move, every little pinch of clay becomes an opportunity to move in a different direction and make a different kind of decision. And that felt exciting to me, and it still does. So these are not, for those of you who know a little bit about clay, they're not built, there's no slabs involved here. There's no cutting out a shape out of a big sheet of clay. They are all just pinch built, you know. So it's take a little piece of clay and add it to another piece of clay. And so they take months. They're all about 7 feet tall. They all do stand up by themselves, but I wanted to have some space under them. It was important to me that they don't just feel like they're growing out of the floor, but that there was these little stands. And, the other thing they do, I started this work as a way of just clearly sort of disrupting, messing with all of my habits and my competencies. You know, I'm so good at making stuff out of wood. And I made furniture for a living for almost 20 years. And I just wanted something that was that took me away from all of that. It required me to think really differently. Which would fly in the face of all of my dogmas as an artist, all of these sort of assorted baggage that I've collected over the years. I've studied with some of the most dogmatic artists of our time, honestly, when I was in graduate school. And I bought a lot of it, you know? The idea that art is ultimately a kind of a, defined as a series of eliminations, you know? It's what you can't do. You know, the very year I started studying sculpture was the year that Rosalind Krauss, the critic, published this famous essay, really very, you know, hugely influential essay called Sculpture in the Expanded Field. But the point of the essay was actually to shrink the field as much as possible in some ways. And it was a series of sort of mathematical eliminations that arrived at the proposition that sculpture can't be this or that or that or that or any of the things that have historically been, and it could only be these other things. And the biggest change in my thinking as an artist is that I, and these, this is really how I got myself there, is that I no longer think that way. I don't think of sculpture as that kind of a problem of philosophical categories or theories that need to be eliminated or defended. To me, it is now a place, you know, of freedom and possibility and joy. And I'm a believer, right now especially, that expanding a space of joy and possibility is a political, is as much a political idea as any other. And so that's kind of what my work is all about right now. Questions?
In between the wall sculptures and the clay,
yeah,
verticals,
there's a bunch of them.
That you didn't mention. Are you putting those aside,
okay,
or do you think they
so the word
together?
Penny's talking. This is my friend Penny. You're talking about these.
Yeah.
Yes. So these are sort of an intermediate place. These started about 5 years ago, and these are wood structures covered in canvas, and layers of canvas, sort of staggered. You can really feel the layers in their makeup. And then the surfaces are very, very thickly applied wax and paint. On one hand, they're a little bit like freestanding paintings, but they're also like dolmens or markers of some sort. Yes, I'm done with these. I'm no longer making these. I made about 20 of these. They got me to those other pieces. The thing that's most important about these, and that I failed to mention about the clay pieces, I'm not just, like, I hesitated to show that new red one all by itself. I don't usually photograph them alone, because what most interests me about them, I mean, I care about them as objects that have, you know, a kind of a pretty stubborn presence as material objects. They weigh like 300 pounds. But I'm also interested in the kind of experiential field that they make. So as you enter into them, they sort of shift the light as you move through them. It feels like they're staining the air, you know, that, oh, there's a green thing here and a blue thing there. What does that make me, you know? And that they are all, these are all about 75 inches high. So they feel and scale very much like their presence. I think they enter, you enter into a place where there's these kind of subject, object, ground, shifting ground that happens. But I'm really, in some ways, more interested in this sort of field they create than in them as individual things. But the new pieces each assert themselves, the clay pieces each assert themselves more as individuals, I think, than these. Which felt important. Yeah,
can you go back to the clay ones now that we've seen those ones?
Oh. These are things I didn't have time for. This is, so just to give you a sense of continuity, these are from 1989. And there's a whole group of these. They're these very refined wooden slabs, hollow slabs that they're like, they weigh, again, almost weightless, and they freestand. And they have these areas of color that sort of wrap around them. Yeah, and so this is all to say that this kind of interest in the map, anyways. Yes?
Could you go back to the flags, please?
Like David asked me to. Wade?
Let's do the other direction.
There we are.
I just wanted to say, I saw these pieces at Carl Sandburg.
Oh, okay, yeah.
College.
Yeah.
About a month ago, I think it was. And I felt like I was walking into a forest. It was the most wonderful feeling of just walking back into that corner and being surrounded by those objects. It was just amazing. So thank you.
Thank you, I'm so glad you saw them, yeah. Yes?
These pieces are, they're just amazing. They're just wonderful. I just love looking at them. I wanted to ask you, I might have missed it. You used the color yellow quite a bit.
Yeah, yellow and green.
Earlier work, and I'm seeing it again now on the bases.
Well, those bases are just wood.
Wood.
That's just raw fir and MDF on the top.
But there was a long run of your work there. Yellow, yellow, yellow.
Yeah, it's true. So, yellow to green. My thinking on color, you know, I mean, when I first started this making sculpture in the 1970s, you know, mostly you thought of color as a container to sculpture. You know, with a few exceptions. John Chamberlain, Donald Judd,
yeah.
A couple other people, but mostly we thought of sculpture as, you know, and of color in that way. By the time I was in graduate school, a lot of that had shifted. And it had largely shifted because of the influence, I think, of women who, for one reason or another, didn't think that sculpture should be dreary and colorless. Ridiculous, I believe it. But, and in particular, when I was in graduate school with the artist Jessica Stockholder, who I worked quite closely with. We did collaborative work, and I wrote about her work. She, over the years, has had a huge impact on my work. Terms of color, especially. She gets color and deploys it at a level that few other artists do. And she was the first person to say, why don't you paint that thing red? One of like the two most biggest moments in my work in terms of what other people contribute.
Could you say something about the narrow line, horizontal line?
Yeah,
there's a lot of good stuff in the other.
So, one thing I know for sure is that I've tried to make pieces without them. And then I like get up in the middle of the night with the shakes. I gotta get there and put the lines on them. I think it has to do with slowing down the form on one level. Just creating intervals, sets of sections. They also become, and especially I think in the canvas pieces, less so in these, like a measuring device, so it has to do with, oh, I see, my waist is there, my knees are there. So it gives them a more direct relationship to the body. But I think the more important thing, well, they create that sort of color vibration. They often have really intense optical relationships to the ground color. They create this movement in this plane, so that to break up the kind of redundancy of the vertical. And reaffirm
so intentionally there in roughly the same vertical position for most of them?
No, but there's enough, you know, that,
It seemed to add buoyancy to the pieces, like floatiness that they otherwise have.
That's interesting. Yeah, I know that the pieces need them really badly. And I definitely can't have them be just solid colored things. But I'm not sure I can articulate everything about them. Yeah.
You know, they almost look like the lines in the plywood. You know, in the other work that you did, the lines cut through the circular part of the wall pieces. Maybe those lines are just a part of your work.
Well, it's also, you know, it implies a layer of geometry. A different kind of structure. And one of the other interesting things about these is that even though they're clay, you know, and even though they're pinch milled, they all have edges and corners. You know, so they still relate to constructed things. I actually can't bring myself to make one that's just like round. You know, I need a world of corners.
How
Are they as tall?
There's about 7 feet.
7 feet.
Yeah. So they're fired in sections, and then in some cases, the sections are glued together, and then there's usually one section that will come off, just so I can carry them, because I hate to be dependent on other people in the work.
Right.
So
are you thinking of them as a group when you're planning the colors?
Yeah, and in fact, that red one is the first one, because of that show at Carl Sandburg, I didn't have the others in my studio, and I painted it bright red. I thought, well, damn it, let's just go for it. So we'll see how that works out once they're all together. But yeah, I always think about the color relation. Yes?
Thank you, sir. I just wanted to state that I think that's probably my favorite shot of your works that you decided to bring together, because the vertical, the horizontal lines remind me of automotive camshafts. The horizontal white lines remind me of automotive camshafts.
Wow.
And so then the overall figure makes me think of stop motion.
Okay.
So I just think that was really cool that you did that.
Yeah. Oh, I see what you mean about camshafts, especially this kind of thing, right? Where the...
Yes.
Yeah. And actually this, this one is my goal with this one was to make, you know, with most of the others, they end up carrying their weight in a continuous axis, sort of a vertical axis that runs through it. There's little bits, they wiggle, but it's not. And this one, I wanted to really shift the weight. You know, I really wanted to, okay, it's over here. And failed a couple of times in the process.